Understand this. Everything is moving in the direction that the Bible says it's moving in. Is coming, and we've got a lot to be excited about.
There's going to come a time of reckoning, and that reckoning is coming soon.
Well, hello, my dear brothers and sisters. We are here for another episode of Countdown to Eternity. I am super thrilled to be here. I am thrilled that God continues to show his faithfulness and his goodness. As many of you know, and I can't get into all the details for those of you watching on social media, but I survived the sickness, if you know exactly what I'm talking about. And God is so good and faithful in that. There will be more to come on those details. And we just have so many stories. And I'm here with the great Don Stewart. And Don tells me he's got a big story to start with. So, Don, how are you, brother?
I'm doing great, James. And again, welcome, everybody. Thank you for having us. Yeah, this story here is something you and I have talked about. But finally, the proverbial cat is out of the bag. Here is the headline. System change, not climate change. Green activists call for socialist revolution at the COP26 Global Day of Action for Climate Justice in Glasgow, Scotland. Now, we've known that all along. We've said that. But isn't this the bottom line, James? It's not climate change. It's system change.
Yeah, we've been saying this forever, and this obscenity that continues to propagate itself as a total lie, especially with COP26. You know, the funny thing about that is, when I look at what happened over there, you can look at a time-lapse video of all of the air traffic control, and the time-lapse video will show you 400 private jets. 400. We're not talking about commercial flights. We're talking about 400 private jets to bring in all of these so-called green conscious world leaders that care about the so-called climate. And the carbon footprint, the so-called carbon footprint that was left by those 400 jets is more damaging than all of the vehicular traffic that exists in Scotland for a whole year. That is not a fake number. That's a true number. Now explain to me how these people are coming concerned about the climate when they just put a carbon footprint that was bigger than all of the vehicular traffic that all of Scotland is going to end up seeing. That is what you call literally insane.
Yeah, the whole thing's literally insane, James, because remember who's conspicuous by their absence, China and India from this, and they're the two biggest polluters in the world. Russia also did not show up with something like this. And there was something like a 56-car motorcade for our present president, too, when they come into Glasgow. So what you have here is a bunch of hypocrites, a bunch of, you know, a globalist, a bunch of people who are using, in the term, was it Shakespeare, the useful idiots that are, you know, going out and saying, we need a socialist revolution here to help the environment, the only way it's going to work. And actually, what's interesting, there's a cross-section of flags of Antifa, Scottish Socialist Party, there at the march. And they said, system change, not climate change. Well, we know from Scripture there will be a last day system change, and it certainly isn't for the good. And Daniel chapter 2 tells us, it's like iron mixed with clay. It doesn't adhere, where you have the leaders wanting one thing and the people wanting something else, but the leaders always get their way, and it's not something that the people will like. You know, it's funny, James. People talk about socialism. They've talked about communism forever, but whenever it's tried, it never works. It can't work because of the human heart, because why in the world should I work if the guy next to me is getting paid the same amount for not working? And that's the whole problem with it, and that's what they never can get away from.
Yeah, and the human variable that exists here is the very thing that makes most of these systems corrupt. And the reality of it is we know that this was the mechanism and continues to be the mechanism that is going to be used to bring in what we know is going to happen in Revelation chapter 13. It's actually going to be used to bring in what we know is going to happen in Daniel chapter 9. All throughout the scriptures, we know that all of this is coming into fruition to allow all of that to happen. And I do think that it is interesting that China and Russia weren't there, and a few others, India. It makes a lot of sense, because when you consider it, every single time they go to these things, they end up having to make some kind of a pact or deal that significantly impacts their economic infrastructure, right? Yeah. So all of the things that these people are calling gross polluting really has nothing to do with gross polluting as much as it has to do with, I want control over the mechanisms that you deploy to create the economic infrastructure that sits wherever you are. China's hip to it. India's obviously hip to it. Listen, the former president of the United States was hip to it, and he walked up there in front of all these people at one of the G summits and basically said, listen, you got to understand, I don't give a rip what you think about this. We're walking away from these deals because all you're doing is trying to force us to put the United States last. And I'm going to tell you something. We are a nation that cares about our people, and we're not going to allow this to happen. Boy, I wish we could go back to those days, couldn't we?
Yeah, and he made a statement, I think we've mentioned before. He said, I wasn't elected president of the world. I was elected president of the United States, and I'm going to do what's best for my country as you should do what's best for your country. And I love that line. And unfortunately, the day the present occupant of the White House took office in January 2021, it was just the opposite. It's not America first, it's America last. And everything he's done from that time on has been America last. But anyway, it's like, here's, there's, have a picture of this person hold up a banner, socialist change to end climate change, the end of capitalism. Well, they have no idea what they are getting into or what they're wanting to get into, but we know it's going to take place. And again, James, along that line, here we go again. You know, we're not doing this purposely. We talked about the Archbishop of Canterbury, I believe, last week, of saying anybody that doesn't stand up for climate change, God's going to judge them. It's kind of like, remember what the governor of New York said, I'm going to make you my apostles. You know,
yes, God, that's right.
You're not listening to God unless, you know, doing this and that. Well, here we go. Pope Francis again. We don't mean to pick on him each week, but he calls on big tech to censor hate speech and conspiracy theories. And so the idea, again, as we get more towards the end, when you have socialism, when you have communism, what do we have? Censorship, right? Because that's, you can, right, only have one point of view. And so here's the religious leader of, you know, the Roman Catholic Church, and he's calling for big tech to censor hate speech, conspiracy theories, and what they call hate speech. We're very well aware of, aren't we, here doing this program, because some of the things we say is considered hate speech, even though they admit it's the truth.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And the worst part about all of this is when you look at everything that's going on and you begin to see the infrastructure behind what this guy is trying to actually do, the bottom line is the Pope wants you to shut up. Yeah. I mean, that's really what's going down. And the thing is he is so in tune with the demonically inspired world system that God is going to allow to be put in place that he's literally stepping in line to do this. And God is going to judge that man deeply and tremendously because he's using the word of God, or trying to use the word of God, or trying to use the premise of Christianity to basically make people do things that are directly the opposite of all of that. He is literally seeking to facilitate the mechanism of the Antichrist. And by the way, you talk about capitalism and how these people oppose capitalism, yet the funny thing is they're the number one beneficiaries of capitalism. And they utilize capitalism to be able to bring in the financial power to continue to sustain the ruling class. And that's what I think is probably the most significant part of all of this. It's a complete farce. And it's sad, but that's the reality of what we're facing right now.
Yeah, and to segue into this, there's a real interesting article I read in the Christian Post. I sent it to you. Fearing Christ's Return as a Christian. And it is interesting because this shows the same problem here in Protestantism too, James. Bible-believing churches, unfortunately, are untaught about the last days, about what's going on, this and that. And they're fearing the idea of Christ coming back. And it's an interesting article. They talk about the dark side of the second coming, this and that, and you know, sending shivers down people's spines studying this so people won't study it. But again, like Paul told the Ephesian elders there, what he thought is the last time he was going to see him. You have to preach the whole counsel of God. You know, Jude 3 says the faith's been once and for all delivered, and we're not to pick and choose. We're to preach the everything. And unfortunately, this has been left off, and that's why we have people like you know, Pope Francis, like the Archbishop of Canterbury, and a lot of these woke pastors that are just falling right in line with what, if you take the Bible literally, what we know is going to take place at the time of the end.
Yeah, that's right. And we continue to see this. I mean, look, it's building and building and building and building. And the thing that's probably the most staggering about all of this is there are a ton of interconnected systems that are beginning to sort of connect to create this interoperability that brings in the economy of the Antichrist. We're watching it. We're seeing it. And all the headlines that we're talking about and the ones that we will be talking about, they continue to point to that very thing.
Yeah, it's like a big puzzle coming together. All these pieces that were all scattered over, and all of a sudden you start seeing them take place. And now, like you say, they're totally interconnected. And now we see them coming together with, and again, the whole idea of socialism, you know, being pressed on, you know, a globalist world. But like you said, these churches, these people wouldn't thrive unless if it weren't for the capitalistic or the free market system, which is the irony of all this. But the sad thing is the Christians, again, we have to say this, are not reading their Bibles, not reading the whole counsel of God or studying it. And it's very, very sad when they end up like many of them, like Peter wrote about in the last day, scoffers saying, where's the promise of his coming, this and that. And so what they opt to the book of Revelation saying, well, he came in AD 70 at the destruction of Jerusalem. There will be a coming of Christ. However he comes, you know, the whole book of Revelation is not to be taken literal. It's symbolic of the struggle of good versus evil. And so we can't get any information out of that. When you and I know, James, if you take it literally, you know, as a futurist, you see everything falling right in line with what the scripture has predicted will come to pass.
And it's strikingly accurate. That's a thing that people don't get. It's strikingly accurate. All you have to do is know what the scriptures teach and then scan a couple of these headlines and you're going to be mind-boggled, because the accuracy of what the scriptures teach concerning what's going to happen in these days is it's like mind-boggling. They all are falling into place so perfectly, and it's so hard to imagine how it is that people can't see this.
Yeah. Now, we've talked about this before, but we've always got new people watching and new people listening. What do you attribute it to? You know, a Bible-believing Christians, why aren't they paying attention to this? You know, Jesus talked about in Luke's gospel, at the time of the end, he said, when the Son of Man comes, will he find the faith on the earth, showing it won't be very big. But what do you think are some of the reasons why this isn't happening?
Well, I think there's a couple of things, right? First of all, the general decline of the condition of humanity is something that the Bible says would be happening in these days. Like we can expect that, and we can even expect Christians to be immobilized, because we have an overwhelming majority of pastors who are not teaching the Bible faithfully. I think one of the greatest attributions that can be created for all of this is the fact that pastors are lazy, oftentimes not really believing the things that they teach. There's a lot of things that are going on here. And the reality of it is they're doing what they're doing because they just have no desire to work or engage in it. Or sometimes pastors don't want to teach because they're scared of being called extremist or crazy, or they're scared of losing people in their church. We're not being accepted, which in my opinion is evidence of a cowardly pastor that needs to quit the ministry anyway. But that's the kind of thing that guys are doing right now. And I think that's one of the greatest attributions to this, the fact that the people are not being taught and the people can't know what they're not being taught. And unfortunately, one of the things they're not being taught is to study on their own, because pastors who are lazy and are trying to hustle the people that they are pastoring will never encourage their flock to study on their own, because if their flock studies on their own, they're going to find out that the pastor is a fake. So, you know, I love encouraging people to study. I know you do too, because not only do we need the accountability, but we want a group of people to be out there that really do know what's going on, because we're running out of time. That's why you make, you know, all of your books available for free on educatingourworld.com. That's why you do the things that you do, because you want your legacy to be Christ. And that's why I do what I do. And the reality of it is that the more we get the word out, the harder we work to teach, to study, to learn these things so that we can pass them on to other people, the more aware people will be. And the reason why they're not aware is because the spiritual leaders are failing.
Yeah, there is an interesting article in this same periodical that I sent you, this one from John MacArthur, and he was talking about lazy pastors who basically take sermons off the internet and just read them and not do their own study. And he said that's wrong on so many levels, because as you know, James, we could teach a passage over and over again, but every time we teach it, there's something new we learn. I didn't see that before. Where's this? This is great. And you do your own study, you study, you read, you pray, and God gives you insights. But by taking something and cribbing something someone else has done or just plagiarizing someone else, that's not only not good for the people, it really doesn't come from the heart either. Because when you give a message from God's word, from the pulpit, you want it to come from the heart. J. Vernon McGee, I love what he used to say. He said, on the pulpit, when you're speaking, you ought to have this little phrase in front of you where only you can see. Sirs, we should see Jesus, which the Greek said to Philip, remember, in John's Gospel. We want to see Jesus, not you. And then on the other side, of course, the congregation sees Galatians 4:16, have I become your enemy because I tell you the truth? And the idea is we want them to see Jesus, but we can only do that by studying, by praying, and getting something new. You know, his mercies are new every morning. And you're right, exactly. If they're not getting the mercies new every morning, not studying, then of course the people aren't going to get anything either.
Yeah, and I have a notation like that on my pulpit. You stood behind my pulpit many times, yeah. So you know. And it basically says, do not strike the rock. And the whole idea is don't misrepresent God. And perhaps one of the greatest ways we can misrepresent God is not by diligently studying and not allowing the truth of God's word to be effectively communicated to people. And by the way, there are a lot of people that are copying sermons online and are teaching those sermons. And I've seen a lot of them, even in Calvary Chapels. I've watched these older pastors give their churches over to younger men who are just entitled, who don't study, who don't know any better, who've never spent a day in their life actually really truly pastoring the flock of God. And so it's just a thing now where they just go online and they grab it and they're regurgitating, in many cases, some of the garbage that people are sharing. And in some cases, it's not a regurgitating of that. They're regurgitating really good stuff, but there's no anointing and there's nothing special about what they're doing because they're allowing all of that stuff to be the very thing that causes them to take a shortcut. As a matter of fact, it's very interesting. When I was the dean of the Bible college, I had actually kicked some students out from plagiarizing some of your work. I had one guy actually plagiarize my work and didn't know that they had plagiarized my work. And I got him in trouble. But the number one plagiarized guy, and this was always a really funny one, is David Guzik. I would actually watch guys teach right through David Guzik's outlines and just laugh because I know, hey, that's his work. That's not anybody else's. And these people don't have the integrity to acknowledge the fact that they're cheating or copying or anything because they're lazy. And it's that very mindset, by the way, that very way of thinking that is causing the church to be the way that they are. And it's sad, Don, because, you know, when I see these guys, these young guys that are pastoring these churches, taking them over, they're not posting on their Instagram things like videos that they're doing to educate people. They're not showing people articles of things that are going on that contribute to the New World Order and all the other things that we talk about. They're showing pictures of them barbecuing with their family and going to Seal Beach and, hey, I went on this run and look, I'm in New York and I'm jet setting over here or look at what I'm doing over there. And the reality of it is they're not taking responsibility and spending their time in one of the most extraordinary periods in human history to be able to take advantage of some of these powerful tools to educate people on the fact that Jesus is coming soon. So I think that's probably the greatest contributor to the nonsense that we're actually seeing right now.
Yeah, and again, that's part of the problem. Jesus talked about in Matthew 24, the love of many will grow cold at the time of the end. That's all talking not only about non-Christians, but about Christians too, or supposedly Christian brothers and sisters that'll be quick to turn on you because you're not singing from the same hymn book they are, but their hymn book is a little bit different what the Word of God says. And if they would open the Word of God would convict them. Remember Isaiah in chapter 5, verse 20. At the time of then, they'll call good evil. They'll call evil good. Paul told Timothy they will actually hate that which is good. They'll actually try and thwart that which is good and you know, produce the evil there. And it's sad. And that's why we always have to have our eyes open. We have to study. And that's why when we do this program, James, you and I both have this idea. We want people to get back to the Bible, read the Bible, right. Get in the Word of God, read it, study it, right. And go to a church that's teaching the Bible, teaching the whole counsel of God. And that way you'll understand. Because again, I'll say it again, Daniel chapter 12, verses 9 and 10, Daniel was told at the time of the end something that he didn't understand. The time of the end, the wise will understand. They'll get it. They'll know exactly what's happening, but the wicked will never understand. And unfortunately, there are people in pulpits who are acting like the wicked who will never understand because they don't teach the whole counsel of God when God has made it, you know, so, so clear.
Bro, it is so true. And it is a very, very, very hard thing to be able to communicate to people. And the worst part about it is these evildoers that are running the society that we see being ran right now, the current regime, which is what I like to call them, that's sitting in the White House right now, the decisions that they're making are so staggeringly horrible. They are based on ignorance, stupidity, foolishness, lies, and yet people are buying it hook, line, and sinker. Pastor, come on. What's going on here?
Yeah, and then you have this. I can't resist telling this. This just shows the complete depth of or lack of depth in this current administration. This article, Black Trees Matter. Vice President Kamala Harris asked NASA if they can track trees by race for environmental justice. We kid you not, that is not the Babylon Bee, that is not the Onion. She actually asked NASA if it can track trees by race for environmental justice. And this woman is one heartbeat away from running the Western world.
Yeah, and I'm telling you right now, she is completely nuts. Completely nuts. And by the way, a total racist. And I'll just say this right now. Kamala Harris either is just faking, and that's a great possibility, or she actually believes this stuff, and she is, in essence, one of the dumbest human beings in Washington, D.C. And that's not an insult. I'm not trying to make it an insult. I'm just simply trying to stipulate fact. To say that this is a form of environmental justice that's directly tied to social justice because black neighborhoods have less trees than white neighborhoods is complete insanity. It is completely foolish. And no one's ever thinking about density of homes. No one's ever thinking about the presence of apartments. And people just don't listen. Kamala Harris is a fake and she's a liar. And the problem is there are churches that are giving her a platform to be able to communicate simply because of the color of her skin when she is by far the most incompetent vice president we have ever had in U.S. history.
Yeah, there's a man named Tony Schaefer. He's a retired senior intelligence operation officer. And when he saw what she'd said at that NASA, when she interrupted the NASA presentation, he said, this woman is a complete hack. And if this is not an act, she is also a moron. I hate to say it, but remember, let's remind the people, James, this person was so unpopular running for president. She couldn't even make it to the Iowa caucuses. She dropped out before anybody else from the Democrat Party. They had, what, like 17 people running, 14, 15, 16, 17 running. And she didn't get to the Iowa caucuses before she dropped out because of the lack of interest in her. And now, because of, you know, a variety of reasons, she's one a heartbeat away. And you have a guy there in the Oval Office, let's put it mildly, that is not in the best of shape, either mentally or physically. And, It's not a good situation on both ends. But the problem is, to make a statement like that and try and bring in, you know, climate change with respect to environmental justice and that, and social justice, it's you can't make this stuff up. It's beyond mind-boggling.
It's literal insanity. It's literal insanity. And by the way, I want to say this. It all contributes to everything that we know is going to happen in the last days. We are running out of time. Jesus is coming soon. And we know that that's the case. By the way, Don, speaking of running out of time, we only have less than a few minutes left. So I'm going to give you the last word. Time went by very, very quickly. And my goodness, it just ran away from us. But let me give you the last word as usual.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, James. What we're saying, as we say in this program, like we say in every program, the Bible is God's word to humanity. We're not to go beyond that which is written, 1 Corinthians 4:6. We're to stick with what's in the book. The faith has been once and for all delivered, according to Jude 3, and we're to proclaim it. And the message we have each week is the same message. Jesus Christ is God the Son, second person of the Trinity, the one way to get to the one God, the way, the truth, and the life. Not only our only hope, he's your only hope too. And in this world that's dark, in this world that's lost, in this world that's got confusion, where, like we quote the Archbishop of Canterbury as a leader of, you know, the Anglican Church, or the Pope, a leader of the Roman Catholic Church, about as far off from Scripture as the East is from the West. We have no spiritual leadership these days, you know, at least high profile. And that's why we encourage each and every one of you to go to the book, read the book, study it. Don't be ignorant of these things, and don't be scared about what the Bible says is going to take place at the time of the end. Because remember, we belong to him. He's promised to take us all to the finish line. He starts with 100 sheep. He's going to end with 100 sheep. And if you believe in Christ, you're one of those sheep. Now, if you don't, today is the day of salvation. Ask him the best way you know how to become your Lord, and he will promise to come into, he promised to come into your life and change your life. And that's the message we have here on Countdown to Eternity.
Amen and amen, bro. And that you literally took every last word out of my mouth. So with that, on behalf of the great Don Stewart, we want to thank you guys. Listen, we know for a fact that you do not have to do what you're doing when you spend time with us listening, but we're grateful that you do. We are so honored and blessed. And like I said, we are literally in a place where we enjoy every moment of this show. We love bringing it to you, and we hope that you have enjoyed listening to it as much as we've enjoyed making it. May God richly bless you as we continue to count down to eternity. We love you guys.
Thanks for joining us, but don't click away just yet. If you want to catch previous episodes, you can find them on countdown2eternity.com. Or listen on your favorite podcast app. Visit educatingourworld.com for additional resources that Pastor Don Stewart has available, such as Ancient Mysteries of the Bible Solved, What Happens 1 Second After We Die, and all other titles are completely free to download. Before you go, follow James Cadiz on Instagram and Rumble. Be sure to subscribe to us on YouTube at Calvary Chapel Signal Hill. Countdown to Eternity is listener supported. Until next week, may the Lord bless you and keep you.